to do tonight is try to put a little bit of the story of the lemon tree in the context of restorative justice. It's not a perfect fit, but there are many elements of the book that I think do fit and are appropriate for this kind of discussion. And, you know, just last night I was talking to a colleague of mine, Marie Fromson, who used to be the director of the journalism school at Annenberg at USC, where I'm now teaching. And he was saying, you know, there are three places that are just, hopeless in the world in terms of a resolution. And one of them was Kashmir. I can't remember the second one. The third is Israel-Palestine. And I understand he's been there. He's reported on it a lot. He's got a daughter who lives in Israel. And yet I don't share Murray's pessimism in the long run. In the short run, in the immediate term, it's a little bleak right now. And even though I don't share his pessimism, yet the question is for us tonight that I want to raise is, how do you heal a wound that's this deep, where legacies of history create seemingly unfathomable pain, unbridgeable differences, where both sides, Israelis and Palestinians, can speak of grievances so profound, people dying at the hands of a suicide bomber, families rendered apart and grieving over the gunning down of a boy with a stone in his hand. So profound as to, in some cases, effectively obliterate the understanding of the other, the sense that the other has a history that's even worth talking about. So in this context, when things seem so difficult, what is restorative justice in this context? And we'll get back to that. But I want to back up a little bit, tell you a little bit about my story. Why is a guy from Milwaukee, raised in an Irish-German Catholic family, end up going to the Middle East and writing a book about all this? And I guess I want to start with how do we even agree? I mean, even in the pronunciation of names of towns, there's disagreement. Which syllable do you put an emphasis on reveals a certain thing about how you see the conflict and where you come from, literally or figuratively. So how do we agree on what to call the root of the problem? If you go back now 60, almost 62 years, or let's see, 61 years now, the War of Independence, if you're coming at it from a standpoint of being pro-Israel, Israeli, many Jewish people around the world consider the events of 1948, the birth of Israel, to be known as the War of Independence. If you happen to be Palestinian, or have a pro-Palestinian point of view, or Arabs around the world would say, no, that's actually the Nakba, which means catastrophe in Arabic. If you happen to be an independent historian, perhaps, I consider myself a journalist, by the way, but historians would say, it's the 1948 war, it's the first Arab-Israeli war. So what is that? One of the things that fascinated me about that is how could, there are other conflicts around the world like this too, of course, but how could that event be seen through such completely different eyes, through the perceptions be so utterly different? My own history, I'll tell you a little bit about my own history, how I did come to write this book. I grew up, as Terry mentioned, in Milwaukee. One of my childhood friends, whose mother was a dear friend of my parents, mother of my friend Tracy barely escaped Amsterdam just before the Holocaust, when they lived actually in Anne Frank's neighborhood. The story that I heard growing up and made a profound impact on me was that my friend Tracy's mom was a child then, it was the 1930s, and they were trying to get out of Amsterdam. They managed to get passage on a ship that was going to be leaving Amsterdam, going to South America. And the father, Tracy's grandfather, refused to buy the ticket because the Sabbath fell, and he was very devout. The family was furious with him because they said, you know, that there are exceptions. In an emergency like this, you can do this. And he said, no. And the ship that they would have gotten on was torpedoed. And I don't know how many people died, but the story that I heard was that this family, Tracy's mom and her family, did manage to get passage some weeks later, went to South America, and then came to Milwaukee. I went to school with this woman's daughter. Now, that's part of how I understood the conflict growing up. I would say that, like many people in North America, certainly in the United States, I grew up with what I now call a sort of Leon Uris version of history, as told in the Exodus. Very, very powerful story, and a very, very incomplete story. The story of the birth of Israel and the Holocaust is a heroic event. End of story. The Arabs are either malicious or pathetic or not present. Later in life, I met a Palestinian journalist when I was on a fellowship at Harvard called the Nieman Fellowship. Her name was Lamise Andoni, and we fell in love, and we were married for 8 years. And both professionally and personally, I began to understand at that time, I had never actually been to the Middle East, but I began to understand that there was this whole other story that what I was raised with was the sense that Israel had to exist because of the safe haven it provided after the Holocaust. I know that there's more complex history to it, but that's a foundational reason why the United Nations voted in 1947, 33 to 13, to partition Palestine into two states. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But then I began to understand this whole other narrative, this whole other side of the story. And I began to see that unless you actually saw the history of the other, no matter what your perspective is, you couldn't really understand where we are, how we got here. And so I started to think in 1998, when it was the 50th anniversary, approaching the 50th anniversary of the Nakba, the War of Independence, the First Arab-Israeli War, I wanted to find some sense of some tactile thing that could tie the history of these two great peoples into a narrative, a story that would be something that would go beyond this sense of repetition of history, that every time we open the newspaper and we see news from the region, it seems like we read it last year, 5 years ago, 10 years ago. Sometimes, if you're old enough, 60 years ago, you know, another kid shot down with a stone in his hand, another person exploding himself in a bar, or a discotheque, or on a bus. And is it possible to write something that would actually connect on a personal, human way with two families? Not that it would ignore this other history, because let's face it, that is part of the story. But it would show the common humanity, and that's really what I want to set out. And it was part of my own background of what I hadn't seen much of, very little of, in the mountains of newspaper copy and the miles of videotape, and now, you know, stacks of DVDs that had been chronicling this long history. How much is it about people reaching across the divide, the common humanity? So that's what I set out looking for this story. And as I said, I wanted to find out something that would go beyond the bloody headlines and the seemingly endless repetition of history and explore the depth of the perceptions of two peoples. Now, I'm going to read a little bit here and there from the book and then talk a little bit about it and then read one thing that I have on bits and bytes rather than on bits of tree here at the very end. But here are sort of a way to sum up two perspectives. This is from a book called Palestine and the Great Powers by Michael Cohen, historian of the era. To Jews around the world, on the other hand, the vote was what Cohen calls Western civilization's gesture of repentance for the Holocaust, that the establishment of the State of Israel in some way represented the repayment of a debt owed by those nations that realized they might have done more to prevent or at least limit the scale of Jewish tragedy during World War II. Again, that's not the sole reason for Israel's existence, but it is a huge contributing factor to the fact that the world of nations